Blog Talk Radio.
How's everybody doing? This is King Nick Anthony, welcoming you guys back to the Swamp. And today, pretty soon, we're going to have a special guest chime in, Auntie Red. She's going to come through and bless us with some of her knowledge, some of her wisdom. Today's events and what we're going to talk about is not necessarily the opinions on what the host thinks or what Atlantic Media thinks. Okay? This is just two people having a conversation, having a good old time. All right, someone's chiming in. See what they have to say. Hello? Hello? 651? Okay, somebody called in. Hello? 651? I guess they ain't paying no attention. All right. So we have a caller on the line paying attention, I guess. All right. Today's broadcast is brought to you by Atlantic Media. Okay? If you want to see everything what they're doing and catch up to what it is that they have going on, you can go to atlanticmedia.wordpress.com. You can see past shows and archives of The Swamp or other broadcasts that they have at blogtalkradio.com/atlanticmedia. And if you want to see what they're doing on Facebook, you can go to facebook.com/AtlanticMedia. And if you want to see everything that I'm doing, everything what I got going on, you can check me out on my website, www.pippinpens.com. www.p, as in Paul, I as in intelligent, P as in Paul, N as in Nancy, pens, as in I have two pens, .com. All right? pippinpens.com. You can see past discussions and broadcasts that I had before on different topics, you know, dealing with the people. And you could just like, share everything that we're doing. Check me out on YouTube. You can like and share any information that you feel applies to your life that you feel can help you out. And get my book, Dragonflies in the Swamp, where I developed my own writing style, the anecdotal prose poem. It's not poetry. They're written like essays with little miniature stories in between and a moral or underlying theme that will cause you to get a wrinkle in your brain, have a full understanding of what's going on in Miami as a person from here and not from South Beach, all right? Understand that. Now, today's topic, what me and Auntie Red's going to get into, and I'm hoping that she can drop some bombs on us, you know, some of that truth, hit us in the chest with it, you know what I mean? Some of that good game, if you will. Not even game or what have you, but just pure honest conversation on the history of black folks, like where we were economically, and did feminism have a part in bringing down a black family, all right? Did feminism have a part in bringing down the black family? You know? Because, seriously, it's a lot that's been going on, lady, over the years, and especially for the last 30 to 35 years. You know, our economic base has gone down. The dollar doesn't necessarily stay in our neighborhood for too long. The minute we get a few dollars, we'll go to the mall, and we'll spend it outside of our communities. And part of that is what's killing us, you know? And then with feminism, I understand it was meant to try to help women out. Well, from what I understand, the white women out or what have you. I mean, that's how it seems on some angles, you know? But bottom line, it was meant to, wait, hold on. Looks like we have our special guest coming in. Let me see what she has to say. Hello? Hello?
Hello?
How you doing, Auntie Red? Hello?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm cool. I'm cool as a fan. Just setting everything up, letting everybody get a quick history of what feminism, how it came about. You know, how it originally started off as something to help women with voting, and then in time it was something that they used to try to have rights for women in the job field, like certain fields. They say that women couldn't be in. Eventually, those walls had to be broken down. And they say that women couldn't vote. Those walls had to be broken down. And women had a right to choose whether they want to have a kid or not. That barrier got broken down. So I understand in the past that it was meant to try to even things out, make things fair. And that I can understand. But lately, especially in terms of how the black community has deteriorated over the years, especially economically, is feminism, today's form of it, of the last 30 to 35 years, has it eroded away from our progress? You know? So just trying to figure all this out.
You're trying to figure out what happened. I'm going to tell you what happened.
All right.
I can't speak for white women because I've never been a white woman, but I can tell you this: the women's liberation movement had nothing to do with black women. It wasn't about black women. It wasn't for black women. And at its conception or its inception, black women were never factored into the plan. It was never designed to benefit black women. What happened was the women's lib movement decided that it was going to ride on the coattails of the civil rights movement.
Okay,
Kind of like every now and then you'll hear the gay rights movement being compared to the civil rights movement. No woman of color can really say that they have been any great gain to her family as a whole or the black community as a whole because we so-called got liberated. The other thing is,
yeah.
No gay person or white woman can really say that their plight was just like that of oppressed black people who needed some legislation passed so that they wouldn't be treated like slaves. I don't have anything against white women. I don't persecute gay people.
Yeah.
But I just do not, there is nothing, there is no group of people who have endured the type of physical abuse, mental abuse, and financial abuse as black people in this country. Nobody. The only other people that I can say that may have been as abused as we were may have been the Native Americans.
Yeah,
but
and even with them they got reparations.
What? But to get back to what we were saying, I think that a lot of people people do not realize that the so-called women's lib movement, along with two other things, did a big whammy on us as a people. And I think that when black women start looking back at what it costs to be a so-called black feminist, they'll see that the price we paid for it is not worth it. What we've done as a people, when you start making it a battle of the sexes between black men and white, black men and black women, we don't need that. We have had to fight enough. We've had to fight enough just to survive, to have to start fighting each other.
Exactly.
And when somebody asks me, whose fault is it, the reason why our relationships, our families, our homes, and our communities are in shambles, it's all of our fault. It's our fault now. I think the last two generations, our generation and our parents' generation, is where stuff started getting crazy. because our grandparents, who are probably in their 70s, 80s, and 90s, these people worked. These people had a collective goal. They worked to try to better things for us. And we have everything. We have everything at our disposal, and we're not doing a damn thing with it. And from what I can see, I think it is great, phenomenal, how black women have gone to institutions of higher learning and become highly trained, because I don't say that all of them are educated. Most people who walk out of college with a degree are not necessarily educated, but they're highly trained.
Yeah, exactly.
As a whole, my sisters have become highly trained in their fields of expertise. They have gained valuable work experience. They have networked and formed alliances that have promoted their careers and propelled them into positions of power. And in doing so, a lot of them have become, they've removed themselves from the collective black experience.
Yeah, yeah. And they made it all about them.
Well, it's not so much that they've made it all about them. They've excluded themselves from the equation to a certain extent. I could never believe, I could never, ever allow myself to be so delusional that I think that because I went to an institution of higher learning and gained a marketable skill and I am able to earn a good living for myself, I can't dismiss the fact of what happens to most black people. I can't dismiss the fact that most households in the black community are headed by women. I cannot dismiss the fact that half of black women have never been and may never be married. And I cannot dismiss the fact that there are certain factors that render too many black men unfit or not suitable for marriage. There are too many situations that are present and prevalent that are beginning to render too many black men, for lack of a better word, unmarriageable. You got a lot of them caught up in the penal system. You have a lot of them who are, I'm becoming more familiar now and learning about this felony child support order or this felony child support thing, or black men are underemployed and undereducated. I'm not indicting black men, but those conditions exist. And it's not just because all black men are sorry, trifling, lazy, wannabe players, and just want to go somewhere and sit their ass down and get themselves together. There are as many factors present and prevalent to keep black men from becoming the husbands and fathers that they desire to be, as there are in place that make these, that are beginning to make what I think a lot of black women successful. There's just as many factors present on each side. I don't think a lot of us have looked at the fact that you can best destroy anything from within. You don't have to put nearly as much effort to destroy something from without if you allow it to unfold from within. And the black family is what is in shambles, and that's why our communities are in shambles. I truly, truly believe that this battle of the sexes, this war among our people, is twofold. But as a woman, I think that quite a few of our sisters got tricked. My mother's generation, who came of age in the 60s and late 60s and early 70s, may have been the first generation of women to get tricked.
Because they end up telling their daughters and stuff like that to do for yourself, don't depend on no man. Or they might have had like a sorry dude around that had a kid with him and left and be like, don't end up with nobody like your daddy, and all men ain't, you know, all men ain't nothing, and talking down upon us and stuff like that. So now the daughter grows up with that mentality to do for you and don't depend on no man. A man is pretty much like something like a pet, if you will. You know what I mean? Like, if you have one, good. If not, so be it, you know?
I think so. I know that I've heard it all my life, don't ever depend on a man. I was taught to be self-sufficient. I was never told, ever, that I would not need a man. I was told that I needed to be careful what kind of man I allowed myself to think I needed.
See, that's the trick right there. That's the trick right there that's missing.
I was never told I don't need a man, and when you first get that first real heartache or your first divorce or whatever you go through, you think that. I was surrounded by good men growing up. I did not say perfect men. I did not say perfect. None of them were perfect. And as I've grown into an adult and had some adult conversations with the women in my family, I've come to discover some of the imperfections and even indiscretions of the men in my family. But I am very, very grateful to the men in my family for showing me the kind of effort that a man puts forth when he loves a woman, when he loves his children. So I didn't grow up thinking that I could have this grand, glamorous life and have everything I wanted and maybe even a couple of children without a man. I didn't grow up believing that. I grew up believing that families were necessary to the survival of people.
Yeah.
So that's why now I look around, and I'm not dismissing any of the BS that some men do that create so many problems in our community. But I have become keenly aware of the fact that there are too many black women under the impression that they don't need a man, that all they need is a degree and a job, and that some of them are even saying they don't even need a man to have a child. All of that,
yeah,
I think,
just go to a sperm bank. I heard that too.
Well, what happens is, when a woman gets it set in her head that she doesn't need a man, not even to raise her child, she may not realize that she is becoming a breeder by default for the prison industrial complex, maybe the military industrial complex.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're waiting. They the prison industrial complex profits off of our ignorance. They profit off of our stupidity. They profit off of the fact that you have all these angry, misguided children who don't come from intact families. They do that. I think that a lot of the problem with a lot of our young people is that they don't have the benefit of a family. And when black women begin to subscribe to the fact, or to the idea, I'm sorry, not a fact, but when they decided to subscribe to the idea that the black man was their enemy, that's when the problems began. White women were rebelling against the oppression of white men.
Yeah.
Okay. We didn't have any business turning on our own men, because The white women were oppressed by the laws and the societal mores set in place by white men, and so were black women, and so were black men. I'm not saying every white man is evil, but we didn't have any business fighting the black men. The black men didn't control anything. They didn't make the laws. They didn't do anything. So when white women started burning their wives and turning against their men.
When I was doing my research or whatever on the history, just a timeline on the history of feminism, like Mary McLeod Bethune, she started up a Negroes Women Association or what have you. But the thing is, they fought for job discrimination, racism, and sexism was last. You know what I'm saying? They mostly rode for the people. You know what I mean, they ain't sit up there and just try to jump in any woman's movement or whatever. They were still for the people. So you're right. The minute that, you know, most black women started adopting that mind state that, hey, you know, I'm with you with this feminist movement or whatever, with the white women, that's when everything started tearing down. You know, you destroyed the nucleus, which is the family, and you pretty much destroyed the backbone of the community. I put that in my book, Dragonflies in the Swamp, that the backbone of the community is the family unit, not one individual as a whole, you know?
It's a family. And what happened to our people, when you start looking at what welfare and the so-called feminist movement did in our community, it had a very devastating effect. Welfare mandates that the male must be removed from the house. You can't get any help if that man is in the house. When welfare first came into play, you couldn't have a man around the house. I heard stories of people telling me how their mama had to, how their daddy had to sleep in the house at night. Had to sleep in the house at night, that, you know, a certain time of month when it came time for the inspectors to come around, but their mom had to hide their daddy's clothes and put their clothes up, and it was amazing to hear. And I come to understand that you could not receive public aid unless you denied the presence of the father. And even now, those women have to either give this man up to the justice system or the welfare system, or they have to say, I don't know where he is. Or they have to say, I don't know who he is.
Yeah.
And you can't tell me that a system like welfare combined with too many women getting caught up in a pseudo-feminist movement that they thought was designed to help them did not play a vital role in destroying the relationships between black men and women, and thus causing almost irreparable damage to our family unit.
Mhm. Yeah, because now some women, even though they're well trained, i.e., so called educated with a degree or whatever, you know, some of them, they don't want to hear nothing from a man, even if that man has qualifications or whatever, you know.
Well, degrees are good. I'm glad that anybody who has one has achieved an important milestone in their life. But degrees, I know some people who have degrees but don't have a lick of sense. And I know self-made men and women who do not have college degrees but are some of the most productive citizens and prominent citizens for the right reasons in their communities, in their cities, in their state, and in this country. I find it disheartening when people allow a glorified work permit, because that's what your degree is. I have a degree in nursing. I'm a registered nurse. The only thing that degree did was say, I have completed a course of study and achieved and met the minimum requirements for graduation in order to sit for the state boards to get my license. That's all that meant. Doesn't necessarily mean that I have any character, didn't necessarily mean that I have any intestinal fortitude, didn't necessarily mean that I had sense enough to pour piss out of a boot if the instructions were written on the bottom of the boot. It just was that I had met the minimum requirements for graduation and that I was eligible to sit for the board exam to become a nurse. That's all that meant. That's all it means for any of us. So when a woman or a man, for that matter, has achieved academic success or career success, doesn't necessarily mean that this is a person who is able to recognize what is necessary to have a strong family so that we can build a strong community or that we can rebuild our community. Many people don't understand that. You have a lot of women who honestly believe that a college degree makes them more marketable as a wife. It does not. It makes you more marketable in the job search. It makes you better able to compete in a tough job market. It makes you eligible for promotions and certain positions on your job. But your MBA does not necessarily mean that you are going to be a good mother or a good wife. My grandmother turned 92 years old two or three weeks ago.
Okay. Happy belated to her.
Yeah, she raised 10 children. 10. 10 children. And I don't think that I could raise 10 children. I don't think I could have raised 2. I had one son, and it took everything I had. It took everything I had to get him to adulthood, to young adulthood, into the military, and I just tell you, I don't see how she did. And this is a woman who didn't have formal education or anything, but she was a good wife and mother.
My mother's mother.
Well, the thing is, I agree. And a lot of women may get it confused when somebody says, you know your role with standing your place. Knowing your role and knowing your place, those are not the same thing to me. When a woman knows her role, that doesn't necessarily mean that she's got to be some mindless person who can't voice her opinion, who can't make any decisions. I think that a woman knowing her role is realizing that you come here first as a woman. If you are married and you have a family, there is no greater job, no other greater role that a woman can fulfill than to have the sense enough to make the decisions that's going to bring her the results she needs to be a good mother.
Exactly.
And what I'm saying is, if you have children, your greatest and most important role is as a mother. Now, once your children get grown, if you've done what you're supposed to do to raise them, they're all their own. But as a wife and a mother, that's a very important job. She is the CEO of her family.
Exactly. Thank you. Are we trying to tell people she's
the COO of her family. Her husband is the CEO. She's the chief operating officer of that family. Because for the most part, men work. They bring their money home. It is the woman who has more to do with how that budget is spent, the groceries. You have some men who are very financially savvy, and they control the budget in the house. But for the most part, it is the woman who makes the purchases of the things that the family needs most to function on a day-to-day basis. And it is the woman who is the deciding factor in whether that building, where that mailbox is, becomes a house or whether it becomes a home.
Exactly. Auntie Red, we're going to have to take a quick 5-minute break. Studio says that we have to do that. You mind holding off for a second or calling back in about another 5 minutes?
Not a problem. You got to give me time to get my cornbread and stuff.
All right. Go ahead and handle that. We'll be back in a second. For anybody that has any questions for Auntie Red, you can call in at 347-989-8183 and just press 1. All right. We'll be back.
Peace. This is City Hampton of the HSDO Lord Mission. Utilize the ancient universal powers of nature. For ages, gemstones have been an integral part of holistic healing. With their unique molecular structures, they possess the ability to emit healing energies that tune the mind, body, and spirit. Gemstone therapy is a subtle and an effective way to help introduce new and positive energies into your life. Gemini Creations, Gemstone Consultation, are a unique and an effective way to calculate the best gemstones for you based on your personal life experiences and astrological information. These consultations help to provide you with a comprehensive understanding of the gemstones that work best for your energy. With your gemstone consultation, you will receive a gemstone consultation report comprising of a list of recommended gemstones, as well as a complimentary prenatal chart. Gemini Creations also provides custom-created amulets, gemstone elixirs, gemstone jewelry, and a variety of gemstone formations. To learn more about Gemini Creations, visit us on www.geminicreations.newshop.com. Spelled G-E-M-I-N-E-Y-E creations.newshop.com. And like us on Facebook, www.facebook.com/Gemini Creations. Peace and blessings.
Gonna get into some more of how the black community has deteriorated and if and how feminism has something to do with it, all right? We're with our special guest, Auntie Red, just giving us her insights on what she sees, what she believes, and much of what she's saying is pretty much is spot on what's been going on, you know? Because feminism, when it first started off, I see the plight. And I do admit how women were treated back then, it was all kinds of messed up. But now, is it how things are today? Does it really apply in today's world? You know what I mean? Does feminism need a overhaul or need to be taken out of the equation, period? Because everything seems to be, in terms of like how women want to do what they want to do, everything seems to be in play. Question is, how much of that are we willing to give up in order to make things work with the family unit? Because if you don't have a man and a woman in a family unit, then you're going to continuously have people in just deplorable conditions in terms of the family structure, you know? The kid might not grow up with a father or a stable relationship with the father, or the kid might not grow up with a stable relationship with the mother because the mother isn't stable in a way. She may have all kinds of accolades and things of that nature, degrees and stuff like that, but who's to say she's right in terms of raising a family? Okay? Right now we're just waiting for Auntie Red to come back from putting her cornbread in the oven. You know, she had on her business. You know? But before she gets here, I just want to let everybody know, you know, you can call in by pressing 347-989-8183, and then just press 1 if you want to be recognized and seen. Okay? Just press 1 if you want to be recognized and seen. All right, that number once again is 1-347-989-8183 if you want to be recognized and seen. Now, when Auntie Red gets back, we're going to get into the solution of things. We're going to get into the solution of things, all right? Because it's a lot of messed up things that's going on, and we need to start coming up with solutions. Hello?
I'm back. Hello?
Hey, Auntie Red, how you doing?
I'm doing good.
Yeah, just letting everybody know out there that's paying attention and that's listening and what have you, that this go-around, after explaining what's going on, we need to come up with the solutions. So what's some of the solutions that you have in mind or what have you?
Well, I think that black men and women have to realize we're playing on the same team. We're not at war with each other. And if we sit down and put egos and pride aside, individually and collectively, I think we'll find that we really want the same thing. It's the things that really matter, we want the same thing. If you are in a marriage or a relationship, when you sit down and look at the big picture, mm-hmm. you and your mate sit down and you put your pride and your ego aside, you'll basically find out that you want the same thing. And if what you want is very different from your mate, and none of your goals are common, and none of your priorities are the same, then you might not need to be with that person. But I guarantee you that if you put pride and ego aside, and you decide that you want to be in a relationship and a marriage rather than a competition, you'll find out that person is not your enemy. And that y'all trying to do the same thing. Sometimes it comes down to our pride and our ego wanting to make sure that we get the credit for what we do, or that we don't want to take the blame for what we did. And sometimes, speaking as a woman, it boils down to the fact that a lot of us don't trust our me, or we're not able to allow ourselves to trust our me. Sometimes it's on the man. You know, sometimes you brothers do some things that cause women not to trust you. And sometimes they bring things with them from their past relationships, even from their father. Sometimes the man that missed your woman left him for that. Sometimes it's another brother, sometimes it's her dad.
Yeah. So how do women learn to get on, learn to build that bridge and get over that?
All I ask people to do is to look at what you're doing and why you're doing it. Now, I'm sure you're going to have some guests on that are men that are going to talk to the brothers, but I'm just going to talk to the women and asking us to think about the fact that we were not meant to be alone. We were not designed to bear and raise children by ourselves. I'm going to ask the men to think about the fact that they weren't designed to be here alone. And to think about the fact that life goes a whole lot better when you have the right partner. Now, there's no worse hell than being with the wrong person. But I do want to start thinking about the fact, first of all, we weren't meant to be alone. Then I want to think about the fact that we've been oppressed enough from outside forces. We've been oppressed enough in a country that up until about 40 years ago treated us like second-class citizens.
Yeah.
We don't need to oppress each other. And we don't need any mechanisms in place that will cause us to think that one of us has it worse off than the other. The feminist movement tricked black women because we were led to believe that we were somehow suffering more than our men. No, we were all getting our ass kicked.
Exactly.
We were all being treated like second-class citizens. We were all being denied our rights. Black women don't have it any easier than black men, and black men don't have it any easier than black women.
Yeah, because we're all seen as either ghetto or crazy or something like that, you know?
Now, I'm curious now, because I am sure that you've got a listening audience, and I'm quite sure that they've got some opinions. I'm sure that some agree with me. I'm sure that some disagree with me. But either way, I want to hush and listen to what those young people have to say. And whether they agree or disagree, I'm sure that by listening to them that I get a chance to sit back and learn something from them.
Exactly. Now, we had a few folks on here call in, and just waiting for them to call back. See what's going on.
Yeah, I want to know, because I got about 15 minutes before I jet off to my next thing.
Because right now,
I
told everybody to call back. Tell somebody, oh, we going on a break. Look like, you know how it is with black folk. You tell them we going on break, they break.
I would like to ask you a question.
Okay, hit me with it.
I think that a lot of women signed on to the feminist movement because they were oppressed in some areas. There were some people that were not treating women right. There were some people who did not see that women were entitled to be treated equal in situations. If we're doing the same job, we should get the same pay. If we're qualified for a position, I think that we should be considered for that position just like a man would. I don't necessarily think that all men were amenable or on board with the women's lib movement or the feminist movement. But do you as a man, can you understand why women thought that they needed to take the measure to get a women's movement started?
Well, from what I understand, like women at some point, they were only seen as pretty much assistants to the man. Like, you stay home, you raise the kids, you do what you're told. And some of the stories that I heard about, like, women from, like, the 50s and 60s, whenever the husband died, they didn't know how to balance a checkbook, they didn't know how to fill out an application, so, you know, the story that's been given, they pretty much were left destitute, pretty much just start all over again if the man went there, things of that nature. And women were seen as less than the man. You know, like, stay in your place, woman, or you'll get slapped up and nobody would come to the rescue. You know what I mean?
No, I don't go along with that. But, yeah, there was a time when a man could beat his wife as long as the stick was no bigger than the diameter of his thumb. Those kind of things. Were the things I think that the women were protesting. And I believe that they should have. But somewhere around the 60s or the 70s, black women got it twisted. Some of them got it twisted and thought that being able to go out and get a job and make a living, being able to obtain academic achievement, made black men no longer necessary. And I go back, I beat the same drum. Between welfare and the so-called women's lib movement, it started a battle of the sexes that hasn't ended too well for my people. It ain't going so good for us.
Yeah, because it's like with the poorer ones, welfare came in, eliminated the man. If you keep the man out of the house, we'll give you this many benefits, that many benefits, you good. Now, with women on the go with some ambition, they were taught that don't depend on no man. Go out, be your own CEO, be your own boss, get into this job field, take over, this, that, and the third. So on the ones with no ambition, they just being spoon-fed by Uncle Sam. And while the ones with ambition or whatever, they're being spoon-fed the dream that they can be their own boss lady. Now, if a man tries to step in and be like, hey, I can jump in, I can help you out, like, with the ones with ambition, the ones who feel that they're educated, so-called educated, don't really know nothing about their own history or anything, they just happy to have a degree and a career going, you know, they battling with men. And if the dude, if I say that the woman, she's making like 70 grand a year. Okay, cool, she's making 70 grand. If the guy's not making 90 grand or better, you know, six figures or better, 6'2" and all these other crazy things on their list or what have you, requirements that's on their list, then they'll be combative toward that guy, you know? Like, okay, I'm making 90, you only making 75, get out my face. You're like, wait, hold up, whoa. You know how many females will kill to have a dude that at least makes over 40, you know? And when a throw that in guy's face and try to dominate a situation as if a dude ain't nothing, you know? And Lord forbid you tell a female nowadays, oh, I'm starting my own business. Like with my scenario, I'm starting my own publishing company and ghostwriter firm. Had a few gigs coming in. I'm working on a book right now for a woman. And this is my first major book gig. I mean, it's not a major because it's major to me. Because, you know, as a ghostwriter, you want those sort of gigs for books. So I'm proud, you know. Through my own hustle, the cell phone I have now, the website I got with pippinpens.com, all came through doing little ghostwriter gigs and putting it all together, you know, selling my books the best I can. Tell a female this, you know, they look at me like, oh, okay. Like I ain't nothing. You see what I'm saying? It's like they want everything set up and established right away, or else you ain't nobody. Then when I come up, I remember how you treated me, and I ain't saying I'm going to be sitting there like, oh, forget y'all, you know, you tried me or whatever, because, you know, I still love my sisters. I'm sorry. That's down to my core. That's in my DNA to love y'all. You know, the blacker the berry, the sweeter the juice, and I need that juice in the morning, noon, and night. But some of y'all make it rough on us, you know, and the ones that ain't got no ambition that's being spoon-fed by Uncle Sam, some of them, they get seditty. Like, oh, I got a house. Like, it's Section 8. So, how come you got a little apartment? I got my own house. Da-da-da-da-da. You know, some of them, they don't even realize. They don't even see the bigger picture of the game that they've been played. You know? Whoa, what's going on? Hello? Looks like we're having technical difficulties here. Auntie Red. Wow. Well, it seems like we're having some technical difficulties here because our guest seems to have disappeared. Well, one of our callers, 210. Hello, 210. 210, you're on the line.
Hi, this is Mazella House.
Hey, what's up? How you doing, Mazella?
Good. This is my first time listening to your show. I agree with what you're saying. 100%. I totally agree. And that I don't know if there's a way we can actually change some females' thought plan or what's in their mind already, because sometimes that's how they're raised, so that's how they grew up. Like, they see their mother's one way, so they feel like they have to be that way.
Yeah, some of them, they get caught up in the drama or whatever. They like, dang, you know, because I got a few homeboys and their baby mamas have a bunch of raggedy friends around them. Like, that, you know, their friends have kids by sorry dudes. I have to admit that. And it's like, because they're in that company, they want to also be in the same misery. You understand what I'm saying? It's a sick sort of mind frame, you know? Like, okay, such and such had a baby by a loser. My auntie had a baby by a loser. My cousin had a baby by a loser. So maybe I should have a baby by any old dude. And then they all have something to complain about. You know, misery loves company. Even though the guy may be a good guy that takes care of his kids, because misery loves company, they had, you know, they talking bad about the guy, even though he's a good dude. So I've seen some of it, man. I've really seen it. And it's a sad, sad state of affairs that we're in.
I agree.
Like, what's some of what you've seen, real quick before we get up out of here, because we have like another 5 minutes to go. So what's some of what you've seen that you feel disgusted you with the destruction of the black family and thus bringing down the community in terms of like economics and stuff like that?
Wait, repeat the question again. Sorry.
How has recent years of feminism helped deteriorate the black family and the community?
Oh, well, basically, y'all already said it with the welfare and getting the checks and the food stamps, you know?
No, but what personally have you seen? Like, what quick story anecdote that you can give us where you like, dang, that's really disgusting, what went down right there?
Oh, I saw this video on Facebook. This girl posted a video, and she was just saying she wanted to thank the government for being a daddy to father, for being a kid. She was like, thank you for the government for being a daddy, because the government not only gives me money every month, pays for my kids' doctor visits, and she just kept listing all the stuff that I guess a real man couldn't do, but the government was doing it. So the government was her daddy to her kid.
Yeah, and that's another huge misconception. They think that to be a father is to just provide financially. What they fail to realize, there has to be some level of interaction where the father steps in and plays daddy, you know, that steps in to help discipline the child, to help guide the child, as a man could. You know, there's certain things, like they said, there's certain things a kid needs to learn from the mother, and there's certain things that a kid needs to learn from the father, especially if he's a boy. If he's a boy, he definitely needs to learn some knowledge from the father on how to be a man. That's if he's a good guy. That's if he's a good guy, you know? And when I say good guy, I don't mean that he's balling, you know, six figures or whatever. You know, he's just a good, honest, hardworking man, and he does the things what a man's supposed to do. You know what I mean? Like honor, take care of his family, protect his family, honor his woman, not necessarily put her on a pedestal or what have you, but honor her, cherish her, protect her, and listen to what she has to say, especially in terms of raising the family. So, yeah, that whole government being the daddy, having money, and you're a good father, that don't mean nothing. I mean, you can sit there and buy a kid a million and one Jordans and all the clothes and the shoes in the world. If you're not there personally, then what's the point? Then you're just seen as a sperm donor, with long-term, sperm donor / lottery ticket, if you will. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's true.
Now, before we get off, I like to have everybody who called in, Auntie Red, like for you to start off and share what it is you have going, your website, anything that you want to promote. It's showing that she's here, but I guess something wrong with her line. Because it shows that she's here, but I don't hear nothing from her. Well, Mayzella, what it is you got going? Like, tell us what all you got going.
I have two radio stations, U3 Radio for underground and silent unknown artists, and also have another one starting next Sunday called Purple World Radio for chopped and screwed music, so look out for those two things.
All right. Any Facebook pages, Twitter that you have going on?
You can look up Purple World Radio and U3 Radio on Facebook at U3 Radio and at Purple World Radio. And Twitter at U3 Radio and Purple World RD.
All right. Thank you for calling in and giving you 2 cents. Auntie Red, if you want to catch up with her, because, I'm telling you, I can see that she's on the line, but something wrong with her phone. So if you want to catch up with Auntie Red, she has a website, www.redvelvet.com. That's Auntie Red's website at www.redvelvet.com. Redvelvet.com. Go ahead, check out her website, see what all she has going. Thank you for calling in, everybody. This broadcast is brought to you by Adaentic Media. You can check out our archives at blogtalkradio.com/Adaentic Media. Check out their website at adaentic media.wordpress.com. You can see everything what I got going or what have you on www.pippinpens.com. That's P-I-P as in Gladys Knight and the Pips, N as in Nancy, P-E-N-S, Pens as in I have two pens.com. And you can also check out my book. You can get it from the website on pippinpens.com and see what else we got going on Facebook facebook.com/dragonflies in the swamp. All right. Oh, and one more thing. You can check out Adaentic Media on facebook.com/Adaentic Media. So you can thumbs up that page as well. All right. Like, subscribe, everything what I'm doing on Nick Brown TV on YouTube. And you can check out everything on Adaentic Media's archive or check me out on YouTube. I'm going to put this on video as soon as I can. Thank you, Auntie Red, wherever you may be. Thank you, Mayzella, for calling in. And thank everybody who called in tonight. Stay blessed. Peace.